This week's video is brought to you by the color powder blue, or as we like to say in Minnesota, powder blue. Because you are excellent, fine, and upstanding and go get 'em kind of students, I'm sure you've already looked at the checklist for week nine. But just as a quick reminder, this week's stories are In the Shadow of War by Ben Okri, In the Hills by Christine Craig, Crickets by Robert Olin Butler. So, as we've been doing, I'm just going to pose three questions, one related to each story. Although, if I'm being truly honest, I might pose more than one question per story because sometimes my question has a sub-question. So, anyhow, we'll see three slides containing questions that pertain to these three stories, just asking you to consider how some of the ideas and concepts raised by the story in the fictional world of literature actually can transfer into your own life so that your takeaway from these stories can go, number one, beyond this semester, but also, number two, so that you can realize that there is application to your own life and just to your development as a human being, and how you can become a better analytical reader of all texts, sure, but I think there's something too about becoming a better analyzer of yourself and the world and how humans move throughout the world when you are reading literature and you're observing characters and plot and setting, all those kinds of things. Don't have to remain static on the page in the book. They can leap forth from the page, enter your psyche, and stick with you for the rest of your life. How exciting! All right, so let's look first at In the Shadow of War, and a little bit of question I have there. But first, one more random aside. I forgot to tell you that the reason I'm wearing these Walgreens cheater glasses today, I mean, I always wear them for reading since I had LASIK. Long story. I'm sure you're deeply fascinated by the intricacies of my personal life. Anyhow, I'm having to wear them because my eyes are so tired from so much screen time. And I'm only bringing this up because I feel like you might relate. Okay. So I know with both of my kids, doing college classes, they are, they're getting a lot of neck pain and upper shoulder pain because of so much online time. And like, we're having to do like the midnight back rubs around here. But I have really noticed in the last few days that my eyes, even when I wake up in the morning, they're already feeling a sense of fatigue and just they're really tired. Now I know you can get the blue light glasses, get your cheap pair off Amazon or get a nicer pair. I know that. But also my more tech savvy son, more tech savvy than I, son, he's set the brightness on my computer screens. He's said you don't need the glasses. You can just put kind of a yellow, you can dim your brightness and all that kind of stuff. Put a yellow filter on your screen, and it really does help. So I just wanted to say if you are suffering eye strain and fatigue, consider either getting a pair of the blue light glasses that you can just put on whenever you're reading off the screen, or maybe adjust the settings of brightness. Thank you. This PSA is now over. Okay, so for In the Shadow of War, we have a story of soldiers and war and a young boy who's kind of he's the observer who's kind of wandering around and seeing what's going on with the soldiers. And there's this creepy, bizarre lady who's kind of wandering around the village, and it appears that she's maybe a ghost. And yet, towards the end of the story, it seems that she maybe gets killed. So there's this weirdness about that lady and the story, right? Where it's a little creepy. It helps create the atmosphere of kind of tension. Throughout the process of the story, we see the soldiers with, even though it's a short story, with a little bit of complexity because they are, yeah, the bad guys, and we're a little scared of them, particularly because we're seeing things through the Omovo's, young eyes. But at the same time, there are humanizing elements to those stories by those soldiers, by the way, right? They're playing draughts, which is British for checkers. So they're sitting around playing a game like checkers, and they kind of like josh a little bit with Omovo. They're kind of with him, and at one point we realize that one of the soldiers, like his pants are ripping, about to expose his buttocks. But anyhow, so we see them as somewhat human, even though they also are sort of these machine-like agents of murder. Okay, that was a real big tangent, but anyhow, they are responsible for, we guess, the death of this ghost woman. But anyhow, I think that the whole story for me, whenever I've read it, and I've read it, more than once, I never know what to make of that. that woman. I'm still not resolved on if is she a ghost or is she an actual human being. I think she's a real living lady who's just ghost-like. Anyhow, that feeling of reading the story of like, what am I supposed to believe here? You're trying to figure out what the author wants you to believe, and sometimes the author very purposely isn't telling you what to believe. But anyhow, it leads me to this question. Have you ever questioned the validity of the reality around yourself? Another way to think of this is, have you ever felt gaslit? Now, that's a very common buzzword these days, isn't it? Gaslighting, being gaslit, and you may use it yourself. I'm sure you've encountered it online and social media, but do you even know like where that word came from? Perhaps you do, but if not, I am now going to show you a quick scene from the movie Gaslight, which came out, I think, in the 1940s. And it's about a husband and wife, where the husband is basically playing with his wife's mental health. He is all about trying to make her think she's crazy, but he's the one that's doing it to her. So they'll be sitting and eating dinner, and suddenly, like the lights, which are because it's a ye olde fashioned-y movie. The lights are, like gas. They're not quite as sophisticated as we have these days. Anyhow, the lights will get a little brighter and or dimmer, and the wife will be like, "What's happening? What?" And he'll be like, "Why, dear, I don't know what you're talking about. The lights haven't changed at all. Are you perhaps not feeling well?" So there is this that sets up this dynamic in their marriage where he's slowly driving her crazy. So just let me give you a little quick glimpse, Kate.
Turn your back on me. What has happened?
You mean you don't know?
No, I.
Why indeed? Why was it taken down before? Will you please get it from wherever you've hidden it and put it back in its place?
But I haven't hidden it. I swear I haven't. Why should I? Why should I? Don't look at me like that. Someone else must have done it. No, don't ring. Please don't ring, Gregory. Don't shame me before the servants.
Please stop being hysterical.
Okay, guys, so you see how he's condescending to her as she's trying to check her reality, and he sort of like finishes with the classic, don't be hysterical. So anyhow, I wanted you to see kind of where that current big buzzword actually came from historically. So now that you've enjoyed the beautiful tendrils and curls of Ingrid Bergman, and you've started to wonder where did the painting on the wall go to? Well, if you watch the whole movie, you'll see how he's totally messing with her brain all the way through. So I just thought it's interesting that in the story we're reading in the class, we are seeing not gaslighting necessarily, because we don't really know, what that woman is supposed to be in terms of is she actually a ghost or not. But I do think that the feeling the story engenders in us is reading of like as we're reading is kind of like we're trying to figure out what's going on and what's real and what isn't real. And I just thought it's really interesting to consider that in your own life, where have there been moments in your life where you have actually questioned the reality that's around you, and have you ever felt gaslit? And I'm not trying to tie that directly to everything that's happened from 2016 through 2020 in the United States of America. Okay, bye. And then for the next story, we have In the Hills by Christine Craig. See how I always have the text nearby so that if I needed to, I could find a good supporting quote and address the text. See that? Yeah. Okay. But anyhow, so in the hills, we have this woman who has purposely like found a home up far away from the violence and the trauma of what's going on, in the city. And yet, some of the young boys who are being drawn into being fighters in the battles, the war, have found her and now are sort of starting to demand food from her garden. And excuse me, there is a moment where she connects with one young boy in particular, and we see his the kind of cynicism and the loss of innocence, where you know, he's realized he can't escape what the world has set up for him. So he wanted one kind of life, and he's realized that he actually doesn't have any choice about that, that reality has come for him nevertheless. Okay. But I think that what's interesting about the woman who's living in, you know, with her garden kind of on the hill away from things is it does bring up the idea of is she lonely or is she in a life of solitude? And really, she's chosen solitude. But I think that when the boys show up, in a weird way, it does underscore the fact that maybe there's a hint of loneliness to her. So I just wanted you to consider, like, just vocabulary-wise and concept-wise, can you think of periods in your life when you've experienced loneliness? I'm guessing the answer to that is yes, because welcome to the human condition. Have you experienced periods, or are there places in your life that have given you solitude? And then just sit for a quiet minute. You might want to cross your arms, sit for a quiet minute, and think to yourself, so what's the difference between loneliness and solitude? It's just something to consider as you make choices and structure your life, to be honest. So run with that, my friends. And then for the last story, crickets, we finally, along that, we have a story that's in the United States of America, and it's set in Louisiana, which is home to the country's largest population of Vietnamese immigrants. So there's one thing you learned from this class. Do you like it when I move my little head box around the frame? So you have to be like, where's Jocelyn game? I'm sorry, I'm not wearing a red and white stripy shirt. Okay, so anyhow, we have a father and a son, and we have the father who is an immigrant who is trying to connect with his remote feeling teenager. Like, this kid has no time for his dad, to be honest. He's more into the consumeristic things that America has taught him. He's got the right shoes, and he likes his, you know, friends, his games, and dad's so lame. Anyhow, so there's a moment, you know, outside where the dad is trying to connect with his teenager and kind of like share with him something important from his own childhood. So they capture some crickets, and they're going to do this whole thing, and then it doesn't work out. So it could spur you, especially if you listen to this question, to consider your own life and when you were younger, perhaps, or when you were a teenager, and the adults who tried to reach out to you. Can you think of a time when an adult in your life tried to teach you something? Hey, how about Jocelyn right now? I'm gonna just say it. Or share something with you and you just weren't into it. Again, how about Jocelyn right now? And was anyone at fault in this situation? There's a kind, you know, we have, I think, we want to feel something for the father in this story, because he's a little wounded by his inability to connect with his son. He feels rejected, and he doesn't get any sort of like triumphant resolution at the end of the story. It's more of that didn't work. And so we want to feel for the father, but really, if you're going to be a truly empathetic reader, you also have to consider, like, where's the son coming from? And can that kid, number one, can he overcome the biology of puberty? I mean, when you're a teenager, on some level, you're gonna be what you're gonna be, because you've got the hormones and you've got the, like, you're feeling like an adult, and yet you're still bound by like the living situation and the rules, you know, from when you were younger. So there's that tension of like, I'm ready to be older and be free, and still I got 4 more years I gotta live in this house with my parents' rules and do the, you know. Anyhow, I mean, you can feel for that kid too, because he doesn't know it yet, but he's having trouble connecting with his father. And if he had a strong connection with his father, that could really be something that's helpful to him during the tough years of teenhood. So for you, can you think of a time in your life when an adult was sort of reaching out and trying to connect with you, and you just had no time for it? Yeah. And was anyone actually at fault in that situation? Of course, the answer could be yes. But in most cases, if you come at it from looking at both people's perspectives, everyone's has a reason for the way they're acting. And if you can understand the reason why they're acting the way they are, you can bring some sympathy to it. And on that note, scene, my powder blue says goodbye.